And welcome to my greenhouse. It's 35 degrees in here, which is so unusual in the UK. So today I thought we'll have a look at what I call living jewels. And while we're at it, we might as well have a look at the Cephalotus as well. So let's get on with it. And we are in. So we're going to start off with Drosera. Drosera are just amazing. If you've not grown Drosera before, there are so many unusual and incredible varieties, and they really are like little living jewels. They have these just incredible little tiny dewdrops all over the leaves. What we're looking at here is Drosera binata variety miltifida and Drosera dichotoma giant. Very difficult for me to separate them. I don't know which is which. They both look very, very similar. I'm sure if I had photographs of them, I could find out which one was which, but I'm not really bothered. They just look so incredible. All these little dewdrops are all little sticky traps ready for tiny flies to come along. And you can just about see on that one there, I don't know if you can see, that's in the way, that one there, there's a fly there, there's a little fly there. I know it's difficult to see on the camera, but I'll do my best for you. So you can just see what a tangled orb this makes. In fact, you can even see a little bit of slime up here where a slug's been at it. But they don't eat them. The slugs don't eat them. They just kind of crawl along them and think, even too slimy for me. And then they vanish. So these are just wonderful little things. So I'm really pleased with the way these have come on. They pretty much died back over winter, but now they've come back to a tremendous amount of growth, and you can just see how wonderful they look. So this little gem here is Drosera nidiformis. It is about to bloom. I usually cut the blooms off because they're not really much to look at. But you can see the kind of shape that we've got there and the tiny little dewdrops, almost like a balloon on a stick. With all those spiky dewdrops just waiting to catch things. Now, they haven't actually caught anything at the moment. It shows I've not got that many flies in here, which is what I want. I don't want loads of flies. I don't want loads of insects in here. I have let them catch things on their own in the past. I used to leave the doors open to the greenhouse, but I had such a bad year for pests last year. I decided this year it is a zero tolerance policy. Nothing is going to live in here other than me and the plants. So you can see how that has affected these in terms of them not catching that much. There's a few little tiny fungus gnats on there. Fortunately, I don't have a huge infestation of those at the moment, but I keep a close eye out. Okay, you can just about see the tiny little dewdrops twinkling in the sun. Really beautiful little things, and they die down a little bit over winter. There are so many different Drosera, much more than you would imagine, or many more than you would imagine, and some of them do have a dormancy, which will take me to this Pinguicula. This is Pinguicula Guatemala, and this one does have a dormancy in terms of the leaves. They have like large leaves, and they die off all around the sides, and they go back to a tiny little few in the center. Now what you can see here is those little few leaves that have started to grow. So that tiny little few, like a very tightly packed cluster of leaves, that takes it through the winter. Now this particular one is a Pinguicula that really prefers to be a little bit more on the dry side over winter. So I try to leave it a bit drier over winter, but you can see it's got this beautiful little flower with that gorgeous spur on the back, which tells you about the kind of animal that is, or the kind of insect that is going to pollinate it. It needs a very long proboscis. You can also see a little tiny fly stuck to it there. Now that shows you that very often, and it's the same with the Drosera, very often the whole thing is sticky, not just the leaves. So you do find that they stick and they attract and catch insects on the length of the stems as well. There are all sorts of different Drosera, look very different. Some of them look the same, but a lot of them can look very, very different from all over the world, even in the UK, would you believe? And some of them do actually go dormant through winter. The ones I've got here, most of them don't. One does, which I can't show you because it's actually in a dormant state now, not because it's winter, because this one goes dormant through the summer. So let's take you over to the one that most people know about. So this one is Drosera capensis. This is the white form. This one is going to bloom. In fact, there's a better version of it here. Great big long spire here. I'll probably cut that off. I usually leave one on just to kind of get the idea of why I cut them off. A couple more there. There's another Drosera capensis. That one is a red form. Again, this was a hijacker that came on another plant. If you look very carefully, you can actually see loads of these Drosera capensis dotted about the place. They're just self-seed. There's another one down there. They're dotted about in different pots, so you'll never be without them once you've got them. So let's have a look at the red form. So we've got the red form over here. Again, another hijacker. You can see this one has caught quite a few insects, and they do tend to curl up when they catch little tiny insects, and that one's going to bloom as well. If you get them on their own in a pot, they go much, much larger. You can see how big that one is with my hand at the back. They start off very, very small, and they are quite slow growing at first, but as I say, get them in a pot on their own and they grow much, much quicker. Over here, we've got King Sundew. So this one is DROSERA regia, and it's really taking off for me now. I've had this a few years. I grew it from seed. I grew it in coir. And I actually grew quite a lot in coir, a lot of seeds, about 10, 12, something like that. And a lot of them came up, or perhaps 50, 60% came up, but one by one they died, and that was my fault because I didn't wash the coir. I didn't know at that point that it had so much salt in it, and of course they don't like salt. Many plants don't like salt. What you can see at the bottom there is how thick and large the roots are from these things. You think they're going to be little tiny dainty things, and they're not. They're really quite large and robust. So I'm hoping that this year this will do pretty well. So talking about feeding them, what I do now, thanks to, I think it was Tim who mentioned this to me, a few fish flakes. You can get a few fish flakes and just sprinkle them on the top, and that does the job. And you'll see over the next few days how the leaves kind of bend over the fish flakes and they have a lovely meal. So let's have another look at another of these little jewels. So this was a new one for me in the last, what was it, March this year, a few months back. So this is DROSERA prolifera. Cute little thing. You've got to get really close to them. I don't think I can with the camera. I might be able to do it in post-production and zoom in on it if you can see that. Lovely little thing. Quite happy with that one. And then over here, we've got, this one's got quite a few hitchhikers on it. So this one is, what's this, hamiltonii. So the ones we're looking at are the circular ones. The other ones are actually capensis hitchhikers. I keep pulling them out of this one, but they keep coming back. You can see a new little rosette there, that red one next to my finger. That's a brand new rosette. Catch these at night time and put the lights on, and they look much more twinkly than you can see now, because obviously I'm fighting against the brightness of the sun here. So let's have a look at DROSERA slackii. This was another new one in March. Again, this one's doing very well at the moment. A couple of new leaves in the bottom there. I think there's a DROSERA for everybody. I think everybody could find something that they like. A lot of the ones that I like, as you might imagine, don't grow in this country, aren't sold in this country. I tend to go for things that other people don't have. I don't know why. I think we all do that, don't we? You kind of graduate towards that. So that's my little DROSERA collection there. And I said we'd have a quick look at the Cephalotus as well, because as you can see, we've got nice new pictures about to open up. You can see the difference between the new pictures and the old pictures very, very clearly. The red ones are the old ones. Now, the reason why I've got such a stark contrast between the old and the new is because I let moss grow on it. And again, somebody else mentioned to me that if you let them grow in moss, they just stop. And it did. They stopped growing. For a couple of years, I had nothing on them. As soon as I removed the moss, we've got new pictures, we've got new leaves popping up there. And it is actually looks very nice with the new and the old together. Now, you know, to remove one of the old pictures, they go very, very squishy. They just kind of rot off, and you can just pull them out as easy as anything. Another couple of clumps here, exactly the same form of Cephalotus folicularis. Beautiful little things. I mean, these will not grow in the house unless you have a house where you can give them a lower temperature over winter. If you have a house with a room that will go down to, say, 12 degrees through a few months, because that's the kind of dormancy that they need. They don't go dormant in terms of they completely die back, but they go dormant in terms of they have a rest and they need those cooler temperatures. This one's about to bloom again. I'm going to cut that off. These can get like 3 feet long if you leave them. Quite interesting to look at, but I prefer to get new pictures and new leaves. So I'll just cut them off now that I've seen what they look like. Again, they're nothing spectacular. A little bit like the DROSERA, just like these little white flowers. So I thought you might like a little look at those. Again, I grow these in a tray. water in the bottom. I use rainwater. I've cleared out my water butts, so I know the rainwater in there is pretty clean. Cleaned out the gutters as well for the same reason. I've also put a filter on it as well to try and avoid getting any larva from any kind of bugs. I've also got some capillary matting in the bottom. It does look like it is ready for a change. We'll get round to that at some point. So there we have a couple of Cephalotus and one or two Drosera. I hope you enjoyed looking at my living jewels. And for now, I'll see you on the next one. Bye.